This video is brought to you by YT Andrew Paul Tech Repairs. If you have a console, laptop, computer or MacBook in need of repair in the UK or the EU, then have a look in the description below this video for details on how to contact us in order to organise your repair. Right, hello ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to today's video. And today we're going to be taking a look at this PS4. It's PS4 with a HDMI problem, as so many of them are, but this one has already been somewhere else for a repair, returned to the customer and then sent over here for us to take a look at. So as you can see, it's on and it's up to a white light, and if we take a look over there, oh god, red fuzzy screen. That doesn't look particularly great, does it? So anyway, I'll give you the email that we got from the customer about this. So it says, hello, I've just seen your channel on YouTube and I think my son's PS4 has the same problem with trace damage from the HDMI port. I just got it back from someone who changed the HDMI port for me. They said that they've changed the port but got no signal. So I opened it up again to check if it had shorted as the pins were pushed in really far. He said nothing had and that he would see if a new chip was needed. He's now said it's none of those and it has trace damage from HDMI port and has nothing to solder to it. Charged me £25 for HDMI change, but it's useless now, only any good for spares or repairs. I feel he's possibly bullshitting me, as I feel it could be his fault that there's trace damage now. Is there anything you can do? I was impressed with your videos, and this is something you feel you could possibly fix. My son's only had it since Christmas, and it was second hand, but the security seals were intact. But because he pulled it off the shelf, he did catch it, and broke the HDMI, it's not covered by warranty. Hoping you can help, kind regards. Well, I'm hopeful we can, yeah. Unfortunately, this is yet another one of those cases where you kind of have to put your trust so much into someone or somewhere, you know. It's like taking your car to a mechanic. Sometimes you just don't know whether you've got a good one or a bad one until your car turns up on the back of a low loader when you drove in there the early in the morning, you know. And unfortunately, here in the UK, we do tend to have a lot of fly-by-nights, shall we say, who don't really know what they're doing. So yeah, I mean, my heart kind of goes out to this person. So I'm hoping we can get this going for them, and you know, hopefully their little lad can get back to playing on his PlayStation. So without further ado, we can see what we have there. We do have display, but obviously something is a little bit amiss. It's either a loose pin, or as I say, you know, there's a pin missing, or they've done a really bad bodge job of it. But let's take a look. Let's take it out of the board. Let's take the board out of the machine. Let's get the board on the desk. Let's get it under the microscope and let's see if we can fix it. Right, okay, ladies and gentlemen. So we have our HDMI port underneath our microscope camera now. Let's take a look at what's happened here then. Oh my god, what the fuck have they managed? What have they done here? Right. Oh god. Right, okay, I think I see the problem already. Where's my other tweezers? Let me just point this out to you, if you haven't already noticed. So it looks like at some point somebody's tried to run a link wire all the way down here. Right, so you've got this differential pairing here to the HDMI port. So it's basically a signal line. So image data comes down here through to your HDMI port and out to your TV, or your AV receiver, or whatever it is that you happen to be using. And it would appear that whatever they've done here, they've ripped a couple of ports. Well, they've ripped a couple of pads out. So they've ripped one here. You can see that's loose. The one next door to it's loose. That one's loose. Oh my god, they're all loose. They're all loose. Wow. But we've actually got a big hole here. You can sort of see it's the brownish, sort of blackish marks behind this pin. And also, if you look here, there's some rather suspicious looking trace damage here. So we can see partially this trace is broken. We can see there, look, that we have a bit of the trace just waggling there in the breeze. I catch it with the tweezer blade, and you can see it wiggling around there. And then you also have this little stripped bit of the trace here. So this middle pad here is actually ground, So I'm not too worried about that. But obviously there's no trace left to this third pin in here on the right. So this is pin three, and not only is it loose, but it doesn't look like there's anything there that it's soldered to, which is probably why we're still getting image, because part of this signal on this pairing is actually still going through to the port, which is here. But as we can see, you know, the other trace is completely missing, which is probably why we've got image and we can see some elements of blue and things like that. But the biggest part of the image is just snowy. And we've also got, I mean, quite how the hell this thing worked in the first place, I've no idea, because you can see we can push all these pins. All these pins are completely loose. It's just a nasty job. So what we're going to have to do, I think, is we're going to have to drop the port. We're going to drop the port and we're going to see what we've got left to work with. So that's going to be the first job, is to actually get the port out of this board. So I'll flip it over. And here, somebody's... Well, I don't know what somebody's been doing, to be honest with you. It looks like somebody's been underneath the encoder IC shield, because that's just taped on. I bet that's not even... Right. I bet you anything this isn't even soldered back on. Are you ready? Are you betting they've just taped that down? Tell you what, just take it out of the camera for a minute. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah, they have. So, there's your tape. There's your shield. Good God almighty. Do you know, I'm sick and tired of cowboys in this game, because, you know, there's some really, really talented individuals in the independent repair business. There really is, right? And I tell you what, a lot of these big organisations could do better than to employ some of them to work in their service centres and sort out their bloody broken stuff. But when you see stuff like this, and you wonder why people are so distrusting of, you know, some third party, you know, I don't know if I'd do that, I'd rather send my machine to Sony. And you wonder why, when you see things like that. I mean, luckily it doesn't look like they've touched the encoder IC, that looks perfectly original. So they've taken the shield off, probably thinking there's something wrong with the encoder, but they haven't actually done anything with it, thankfully. So the encoder, I'm sure, will be absolutely fine. The snow and the fuzz won't be down to the encoder. It's down to whatever these clowns have been doing. So we'll put that shield back on again later, once we've finished here. But we are going to have to drop this port first before we do anything else. I don't think this is going to take much work with the quick to get it out, do you? What's your betting this port more or less falls straight out as soon as we get some hot air by it? So, just get the soldering iron out here, put some leaded solder on the pads. Just work some initial heat into the board. Okay, so we've got some initial heat there now. And we've got some nice leaded solder and the flux worked into the board, so let's get this port out. So we're just going to start working the hot air. Back and forth. So we're at 490 degrees C. The air flows at 100 litres of air per minute. So we're just going to start getting this port nicely molten. So you can see the ground feet now are nice and shiny. Well, it's putting up more of a fight than I thought it was going to do, I'll be honest. Oh, there we go. Not much more, though, eh? Not much more. Right, we'll get rid of that. We'll put some new solder down here. Lovely jubbly. Okay. So, let's flip it over. Let's see what we've got to work with. Oh, yeah. It's actually not too bad. So, well, it's bad considering it's supposed to be somebody who knows what they're doing's done it, but, you know. It's not too bad considering we've got to fix it. It's not as bad as I envisaged it being, let's put it that way. So, let's get you in focus. So there's the HDMI header. And you can see... what have they tried to do with that? I'll tell you what, just so we can see better what they've tried to do with it. I'm just going to get some IPA on here. Just to clean the flux residue off. Just so we can try to appreciate what was going through the mind of the technician who did this. Let's see if we can appreciate what was going on here. So, you can see there's a massive great hole in the board here. So, that's the end of a trace, which would have gone... there's a left-hand differential pairing to this pin here, pin 3, that's now completely lifted out, the edge of the trace is there. This second pad here would be ground, pin 2, there's a little bit of it left here. I'm going to try and pick that out if I can. Not that it's serving any purpose now. Okay, got rid of that. So, we have the pin here on the left, pin 1. That still seems to be okay, albeit the tray seems a little bit... Well, it's exposed. I don't know if it's chewed up any, but it's probably just exposed by the looks of it. So it should be fine. So what we're going to have to do then is, we've got this third pin in here. We're going to have to run a link wire back down to this differential pairing here. Pin 1 will check and make sure that that has continuity to this via here, which is where it goes through the other side of the board to the encoder IC. This pin here is ground. We've got plenty of other ground pins in here, so I'm not too concerned about that. There is some very interesting sort of bridging, or something that looks like bridging, to be going on over here. So we'll just have a look and see what's going on there. Hopefully those pads aren't loose, because otherwise I'll be taking back what I said about this not being so bad. On first impressions, this wasn't so bad. But who knows, it may be about to get a whole lot worse. Okay, so we've cleaned that up, and now they were just bridged. They were just bridged together, so that won't have been helping anything either. So, you know, in the end, this actually, like I said, considering it's supposed to be done by somebody who claims to know what they're doing, to be offering this service out to paying customers, yeah, it's a bad job. As far as us actually going about and fixing it, nah, not too bad at all, really. So this one should repair quite easily, quite nicely in the end. And hopefully we'll get that little boy gaming again and get his Christmas present back to him. Okay. So, bearing in mind, you know, I dad myself these days, and although my daughter's just about coming up to two, you can still appreciate just how hard you've got to work for these Christmas presents and how gutted the kids are when they lose their favourite toy because it's broken, and probably been nagging his mum and dad for months up to Christmas. And then he tugs the wire and breaks it and send it somewhere else, and it's okay, you know, we'll send it off, we'll get it fixed for you, and then it comes back and they've done that. It really makes me mad, you know, it does, it makes me mad, it makes me angry. And again, you know, another case where not only has somewhere had the, you know, messed up somebody's machine, and they've charged them for the privilege. It'll do. Right. Because we haven't actually got to run a wire to that point, have we, thinking about it? We've just got to make sure we have continuity. So, multimeter is in continuity mode. That is the mode where it will make a beeping sound when the two probes are touched together. So hopefully you'll be able to hear this. Yep. So what we're going to do is we're going to put one probe on pin one. That's the pin on its own there at the end. And we're going to put a pin down here on the right hand side of this differential pairing. And you can hear there you have continuity. So that trace is indeed good. It's just exposed. So we'll make sure we recover that with some conformal coating. And then, okay, so we're not bothered about pin 2, the ground pin. That can stay out. But we will need to run a pin for pin 3 to complete that differential pair. So hopefully then this thing should work quite nicely. So brand new HDMI port out of the packet. We do stock these if you're after HDMI ports. We can supply them in large quantities for you if you're a business, or we can just sell you one or two if you're a private individual. Take a look in my video description below. You'll find an email address there. It's ytandrewpaul@outlook.com, my business email address if you want some. Just drop me a message on there and I'll happily sort you out with some. For a very good price as well. Cheaper than eBay. The V2 ports we use, so those are the modified ports from the SAC and later Revision motherboards with a fixed back. So the pins don't push out of the rear of these ones, so they're really nice quality. Good quality ports. I use them myself, I use my own stock, so I wouldn't use them if I didn't think they were good. So I'm just going to apply some flux to the pin header. I'm just going to change the tip on my soldering iron. Of course, we're using a JBC soldering iron these days. So I'm just going to tin this header up for you. So I'm just going to apply some solder to the header pins. Get some in pin one as well. Okay, so what we'll do now is we'll get the hot air and we'll drop the port into the board. Are you ready? So we're just working the hot air back and forth to melt the solder. So we're watching for it just to shrink through the holes, become flush with the level of the board, which is now done. So we're just going to keep hesitating the heat over it for a little while longer. And we're just going to drop our new port in, hold it flat. And there we go. And you'll notice as well that that gives you a really, really nice solder joint underneath the port as well. So drop the old port, put leaded solder on the bottom, leaded solder in the top, get it nice and hot with some decent flux. When you go to drop the new port in, it'll solder itself into position and it'll look just as nice as that. That's a quick little tip for you. So there's the header. So the first thing to do is to get those pins soldered. That's what we're going to do now. So I'm going to get some flux on the board. Don't worry, because any excess will get cleaned off later. It's always better to have too much and not enough. Let's get that little bit there that's blocking the view of the scope camera. Okay. And we're just going to drag our soldering iron slowly up here onto each pin, and the solder we placed onto the pads earlier will follow the iron, wick up onto the pads, and we'll solder everything nicely in place. All we've got to do then is just go over each one, make sure nicely soldered. So because we've got a nice uniform amount of solder on the pad, you'll notice that when we drag the iron across, it doesn't actually bridge onto the other pins, because we've got a perfect amount of solder on the pads. So there's no excess there, so you can just drag the soldering iron across with the flux. And you get a nice easy solder joint like that. So we're just going to go touch the end of each pin and pad, just to make sure that everything's nicely flowed along the length. Of the leg. There we go, that should be that. It's as difficult as it needs to get. Which is made really, really easy with this JBC soldering iron I've got these days. The Jovi was very good, though. The Jovi we had before the JBC was a very, very good iron as well. And the Jovis are only 150 quid. So if you're looking for a perfect soldering iron for PCB rework, I'd say go for the, and you're on a budget. If you're not on a budget, the JBC. If you are on a budget, go for the Jovi. That's what I'd do. Trust me, I've experienced both. Get another cotton bud. Once a little bit drier. Okay. So there we go. We've got the biggest part of the alcohol up. So you've got to give these pins the nudge test. This is what you should always do once you've replaced the port and you're happy you've got no bridging. I mean, we can see we've got no bridging because we've got a microscope, but if you haven't, you should test it with a multimeter. And then give each pin the nudge test. So that's the end of a fine tweezer blade. Give each pin a push. Make sure that they're all soldered correctly. If any move, you need to resolder them. So there's nothing to solder those two, of course. And the end one. Yep, doesn't move. Perfect. And that's it, really. So, all we need to do now, like I said, we're not going to do anything with pin 2. Pin 2 isn't really important to us. Somebody's already had a go at running a link wire to this, by the looks of things. Don't know why they took it off. Unless they didn't know what they were doing. Right, so I'm just going to get something here. And this stuff, if you've been following the channel, you'll know exactly what this is and what's coming next. This is enameled wire. Enameled wire. This stuff, really, really fine stuff. I also sell this. Individual reels, so if you need some, you know where to come. So this is enameled wire, also known as magnet wire, transformer wire. It's got a clear enameled coating on it, so it looks like exposed copper, bare wire, but it isn't. So all you do is you offer some heat and solder up to the end. The enamel shrinks off and it allows the solder to adhere to the wire. So the advantage behind that is because it's actually got no PVC sheathing on it like traditional wire has, it's a lot finer and it's a lot better for use in applications where you haven't got a lot of room, like the back of HDMI ports, for example. So I'm just going to tin the end of this wire up and then we'll show you. Okay, so I'm just going to trim this in a minute, but you can see there now that the end of this is completely exposed. So because we've done that, we'll be able to solder it now to our HDMI port. So I'm just going to trim the end off because we don't need quite that much wire exposed at the end. You only need a couple of mil. And we're going to get our soldering iron back in. I'm going to have to try and solder this with my left hand, so if anybody who doesn't know or doesn't follow the channel, me soldering with my left hand is highly amusing because I've always said my left hand is purely for decorative purposes only. It shouldn't be used for anything in particular. Got some flux on the old wire. Better. What we need now is we need to run this wire back down to where it needs to go. So to do that, you're going to need a couple of pairs of tweezers. You're going to need one to hold it where you want to bend it, which in our case is anywhere around here, and then you get the other pair. And bendy bendy. And you can see we've run that right across where we need to join it to our board. So now I need my Stanley blade, complete with its chipped end, so this could be fun. Now then, I'm going to get my other tweezers and I'm going to hold it somewhere fairly close to where I want to cut it. So I want that wire to be straight. And I want to cut it about there. Lovely. Okay, so now I'm going to tin the end of my soldering iron again. And we're going to solder the end of this wire, hopefully. It's our via. So first of all, I'm just going to try and expose the end of it. Just going to work the heat back and forward on the end of it a little bit. So it's nothing too dramatic. I'm just going to pop a little bit of flux down onto the end of the wire and the via. You'll notice there now, our wire is nice and taut, it's nice and stiff, it's flat to the board. The pin itself, you can see, is nice and straight, so there's no tugging force pulling it left or right. Like I said, the wire is flat to the board, which will support it nicely going forward. You know, if the machine gets knocked or anything, the weight of the wire is supported against the board and it's not going to be tugging on these joints at all. So that should be that. Pin 2 we don't care about because pin 2 is ground. We've got plenty of other ground connections on that port, so missing one won't hurt it. And we're just going to go in there now with some IPA on a cotton bud. I'm just going to clean off the biggest part of the flux residue. We'll clean this off fully later on before we go to reassemble the machine, but for now, just to get rid of the biggest part of the mess. And then we've got one more thing to do before we can say we're finished with this repair. Yeah, we've got to test it, but that isn't the right answer. There's one more thing we need to do. I will explain to you why that one thing is very, very important in a second. So just going in now with the dry end of the Q-tip or cotton bud, wherever you're from, whatever you like to call them. Here in the UK, these are cotton buds. Feel free to call them whatever you like. So, see there now our wire there is nicely attached to our via. So that completes our circuit repair to our dodgy pin. So, remember earlier on, how we said, I'm just going to kill a fume extraction because we've done soldering here now. Remember what we said earlier on about the exposed part of that trace to pin one, and also we've got the very, very edge of the trace to pin three there exposed. And then we've also got down here, obviously, we've got our solder joint here, which is there. And we've also got our, you know, these couple of vias here and here are all just showing a little bit. So they're exposed. So the protective coating that obviously came from when the PCB itself was produced is now missing. And if you want to see why it's important to make sure that this is properly insulated up afterwards, take a look at a video on our channel about an original Xbox with an E07 hard disk drive timeout error. That was actually caused by a nick across a trace, very similar to the ones we've just replaced, the ones we just repaired, on a motherboard which was exposed. And what actually happened there was, over time, the moisture in the air actually got into the copper inside the PCB and corroded it, and it ended up eating through a couple of traces and left a big hole in the board. And that was some really fine solder work there. That was really, really tiny, small-scale stuff. But we managed to get it going again. But, you know, you don't really want to be doing that if you can at all help it. And that's what this stuff actually helps combat. So when you're missing the coating from the board, or the coating's a little bit weak, then you can use this stuff to put it back on. And like I said, most people who follow the channel will probably be aware of this stuff. And I'll give you the part number in a sec, as I always do, because this is excellent stuff. So you can see there now, oh, there's a little bit there. A little bit there. Cool. Okay. Everything else looks fine there now, though. All nicely insulated up. Lovely. That's looking nice. So, yes, this stuff is called conformal coating, or PCB overcoat, depending on, again, which brand and which pen and everything else that you happen to like. It's essentially just an insulative paint that you put onto the board. And the one that we use, and that I highly recommend, is this one here. We'll try and get it in focus of the camera. Ooh, we'll try. We'll try. We'll do it. We will. I'm trying to do it one-handed, though, so bear with me for a second. But you can see this one here. Ooh, doesn't look funky under the microscope. This one is MG Chemicals. It's an overcoat pen in green. It's a 5mm pen, but believe it, I've had this pen for a while and it's not run out yet, so you don't use a lot. The catalogue number there, the part number in case you do want to order it from anywhere, is 419D-P-GR. They do different colours as well. They do a black and I think a blue, but the green one seems to work nicest for me. So this will take about 10 minutes or so to cure. You don't have to put heat on it, the air will dry it out. It's already started, you can kind of see it's at the edges of the liquid, it's starting to harden up. So once that's hardened and everything's okay, we'll get this back in the chassis, We'll plug it in, we'll test it, and hopefully we'll have an image back on our PlayStation. Right, okay, ladies and gentlemen, so we have our PS4 reassembled. I've gone out on a limb and put it all back together, so if this doesn't work now, I'm going to be turning the air blue within the next 30 seconds. So let's turn it on, let's see what we get. The machine is booting. There's the screen. What do we see? Hey, PlayStation screen, no fuzz. That's always a good sign. Before it was dancing around in little red dots, if you remember. Beautiful. There we go. Back to normal. Everything working. Screen output back to normal. No more red fuzz, no more dots, no more anything. 1080p glory. Everything back together, everything working properly and as it should do. So, what do we do there today then, ladies and gentlemen? Well, a bit of a funny one. One that had been sent to another repair shop at some point and they'd butchered the HDMI header. Luckily, they'd not done too much damage to it. They'd only lifted a couple of pads out. But, you know, a couple of pads. There was a big hole in it. I don't even know what they've done. They've not even really lifted the pads out. They've made a real old mess of it, and then in trying to repair it, it looks like they've just made it worse, and we've ended up with a bit of a crater. But thankfully, it was only the one pin that really mattered. The second pin in from the right-hand side on pin 2 actually didn't matter in the end. It was okay, because that was a ground pin, and there's another 4 or 5 under there. So it didn't really need it, so we could leave that one out. Pin 3, however, was the left-hand side of that right-hand differential pairing. We needed to rerun the link wire to that. It looks as though somebody's already tried to do that at some point, because the via was tinned up as though somebody had already attempted to run a wire there. Now, either they couldn't do it and they gave it up as a bad job, or, well, God only knows what they were doing, but it wasn't there when we went in, and that's why the screen and the fuzz was like it was. And yet, in the end, despite the fact that they'd butchered it and they hadn't got it working again, they charged the customer £25 for a new port. Unfortunate, but what can you do? Anyway, not too bad in the end, just the one wire needed to be redone and the port replaced, and we're back to normal again. So thankfully this customer's little boy is going to get their PlayStation back. So it was a Christmas present. You know, what are we in now? March. So they hadn't had it long, and unfortunately, you know, almost didn't get it back at all, did they? But luckily it's come to the right place and we've got it all back up and running again. So I thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. Hopefully you've enjoyed the video. If you have, please give it a like and a thumbs up below. It all helps the channel grow, and obviously it helps me work out that what I'm doing here is worthwhile and is being enjoyed by you all, so it'd be very much appreciated. If you have any questions or any comments on what we've done today, then feel free to pop them below in the comment section, and I do read as many as I can and answer them. Again, if I know the answers, I'll give them to you. You can send me a private message on here. Alternatively, you can send me a message on Twitter. My DM inbox is at YTAndrewPaul. It's open to everybody there. You don't have to follow me and I don't have to follow you. The DM box is open to everybody. You can just drop me a message straight in there. And like I say, if I know the answer, I can help you out, I'd happily do so. If you're in the UK or the EU and you want a repair of your own, then feel free to take a look in the video description below and you'll be able to see that my email address is in there. It's ytandrewpaul@outlook.com. That is my business email address. So if you're in the UK or the EU and you're looking for a console repair or a MacBook repair or anything like that, then feel free to drop me a message and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. If you are a business or you're a hobbyist like myself and you're in need of some components and some parts to repair machines with and things like that, I can help you out. We do stock components and we do ship components worldwide. So if you're in the US and you're looking for components for PlayStations, Xboxes, MacBooks and everything else, then feel free to hit me up. I'll see what I can do for you. So yeah, thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. And luckily, that's another one we can tick off the list as a successful repair. So thank you for watching. Hope you've enjoyed it. I hope life treats you well. Until the next time, I'll see you on the next vid. So for me, for now, is bye-bye. Many thanks for watching then, ladies and gentlemen. Hopefully you've enjoyed this video. If you have, then why not check out these recommendations below. Also, please remember to comment, rate, and of course, subscribe to the channel if you found this useful. We've plenty more content on there, and there's lots more to come.